स्टील्स। वी हैव मिस्टर पंकज सतीजा, चीफ रेगुलेटरी ऑफिसर्स, टाटा स्टील लिमिटेड। वी हैव मिस्टर महेंद्र कुमार गुप्ता, मैनेजिंग डायरेक्टर, स्टार वायर। वी हैव विद अस मिस्टर शरद महेंद्र, सीईओ JSW। वी हैव मिस्टर अरुणेश भारती, जनरल मैनेजर एट जिंदल स्टील एंड पावर लिमिटेड। वी हैव देन मिस्टर आर वी श्रीधर, एग्जीक्यूटिव डायरेक्टर एंड सीईओ आर्सिलॉर मित्तल निपन स्टील। वी हैव मिस्टर सौरभ अग्रवाल, हु इज अ पार्टनर विद ENY। देन वी हैव मिस्टर रिची बंसल, सीईओ ऑफ रामा स्टील्स। एंड फाइनली वी हैव मिसेस रीता सिंह, चेयरपर्सन कम मैनेजिंग डायरेक्टर, मेस्को स्टील। सो आई मीन इट्स एन ऑगस्ट पैनल, सीनियर पैनल, एंड 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 विदाउट वेस्टिंग मच मच टाइम, आई वुड यू नो रिक्वेस्ट मिस्टर गोयल, मिस्टर आर के गोयल, टू स्टार्ट विद द डेलिब्रेशंस एंड शेयर हिज व्यूज एंड थॉट्स ऑन द सब्जेक्ट। सो पर स्पीकर सर, वी वुड बी गिविंग अबाउट 8 to 10 minutes पर स्पीकर, एंड आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट ईच एंड एवरी वन टू जस्ट स्टिक टू द टाइम लिमिट सो दैट वी हैव सम टाइम फॉर Q&A एज वेल। थैंक यू। मिस्टर आर के गोयल,
you have to unmute sir. Gupta sir, you have Goel sir, you have to unmute yourself. Yes, now fine.
So I will be speaking basically on behalf of Alloy Steels Producers Association, typically known as ASPA. May I request Mr. Alam to put my presentation, share the screen. Yeah, please. Next, please. Next. So first of all, I'd like to thank ASSOCHAM to invite me for this presentation and participate in this conference, where we can voice our concerns and issues related to the draft PLI scheme. I also thank the ministry that they have given their good importance or extraordinary good importance to the specialty steels. And I like to give few excerpts from the draft scheme, what they have mentioned categorically and the importance which they have given to the specialty steels. Like they are mentioning, Indian steel industry presently operate at a fairly lower end of value chain and is not competitive in higher grade of alloy steel. Now all these points really tells about their very, very good understanding about the status of specialty steel manufacturing in the country. Another point is there is thus a need to incentivize the domestic steel industry to move up the value chain by focusing on increasing production of specialty steels. National steel policy has set a target of domestically meeting the entire demand of high grade automotive steels, electrical steels, special steels and alloys for strategic applications by 2031. This vision can only be achieved if the domestic steel industry is incentivized for enhancing production of such specialty steel grades. So all these points in the draft policy indicates the importance in the mind of people in the ministry. Next, please. Some more, like the Indian exports are almost 9 billion and imports are 10 billion. And it is this gap is largely because of the specialty steels has more than $2 billion worth of specialty steels, which in terms of quantum is very small, but in terms of value, it is very large. And it's getting imported into the country at a very high premium prices. If it is produced in the country, that actual cost will be much lower. And let me mention here, a very, very good large portion of the specialty steels for several sectors, which I am going to explain later on, is imported by government, semi-government and PSU companies. India's import basket typically comprise high grades of alloy steel. Now look at the value creation. These are all above 2000. Not only up to 2,500, it goes up to almost $30,000 per metric ton. The main reason for such skewed figures in our steel import and export is our limited production capacities of higher grades of alloy steels, as I mentioned before. Next. Now, another important thing which is mentioned in the draft PLI scheme is the objectives. The objective of the PLI scheme for specialty steel is to promote manufacturing of specialty steel grades within the country. This would not only help in reduction, elimination of import of such steel grades, but would also help the country emerge as a strong exporter of such value-added steels. PLI incentives shall help the Indian steel industry mature in terms of technology as well as move up the value chain. Now, all these points are mentioned in the draft scheme. Next. Now, here it's very important. Let's understand what is a specialty steel. Now, specialty steels are typically used for applications in defense, aerospace, nuclear, oil and gas, automobiles. And these are the steels which has superior mechanical properties, corrosion resistance properties, high level of metallurgical cleanliness and consistency, and very specific chemical restrictions and very high cleanliness in terms of inclusions and oxides, etc. Next. Now, some of the manufacturing processes by these, which these steels are manufactured, are vacuum induction melting, electroslag refining, vacuum arc remelting. So they are very, very specified manufacturing process, or VOD or VD. Now, these steels are highly clean as compared to the commodity steels which are run of the mill. These are the products which are required in very, very small quantities and are really a special product which requires not only basic steel manufacturing processes, but remelting process and subsequently a very high level of customization in terms of rolling, in terms of machining, in terms of forging, in terms of heat treatment and all. And it requires, even subsequent to steel manufacturing, very large facilities. Next. Next. Now, some of the applications, as I mentioned before, are in defense, space, aviation, power, nuclear, oil and gas, and auto. And let me tell you that the type of focus our Prime Minister has to make the country Atmanirbhar in all these segments, once our requirement in some of these segments which are strategic to the country goes up, we will not get these variety of steels. Now, the people abroad may not support for our defense programs, for the steel required in the defense program, and which is required to be produced by very, very specified processes of VIM, VAR, ESR, etc. Next. Next, please. Now, here I'm showing you some of the applications. Now, why I'm showing you all this, that let's understand, even though the ministry has very well articulated everything, but I don't think it is very well understood. When we see specialty steel, what are the real applications? Now, these are required for gun barrels, which is a very, very difficult application in terms of fatigue, in terms of high pressure, which is generated when a shell is passing through the barrel, missile bodies, torsion bars, parts of BrahMos missiles, rocket casings, shells. All these are produced in the country. They are produced by our members, including us. We are producing steels for all these varieties, all these applications. Next. Now, similarly for the space applications, aviation, gears for light combat helicopters, landing gears, power couplings, various parts which are required by VSSC, Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, parts for Chandrayaan, parts for Gaganyaan, they are all manufactured in the country. And these are small quantities, very highly specialized products and all. And these are the materials for which, as I mentioned before, the foreign people, foreign parties, foreign manufacturers may not support us. Next. Next, please. Yeah. Then similarly for the oil and gas, oil and gas. Now, largely we are exporting this these components. And same thing for the civil nuclear application, which sell it, we produce it for the nuclear sector in the country. So these are really specialist steels. not otherwise what has been mentioned for various and larger portion of the incentives in the PLI scheme. Next, please. Yeah. Similarly, for even in the automobile sector and all, they are highly critical applications which are required for rotating parts. In power, turbine blades, rotors, thrust blocks. These are the real critical applications. Next. Now, why much larger incentives are required for specialty steels? These are the products. These are the steels which requires are highly technology intensive. They require large investment per unit of the production. The order sizes are very small, from 50 kg onwards, or even in some cases we get orders of 10, 15 kg and we have to melt a full heat. Then these are very high value added steels. As I mentioned, this goes up to 30,000 or even more than that. And a very large portion of this is imported, not only the steel. Since the steel is not available, people are importing the components itself. So we lose the opportunity, one, for manufacturing steel, second, for manufacturing component. And this is a niche and small market. Next. Now, as I mentioned, there are several subcategories which are totally missed in the draft PLI scheme, are remelted steels, super alloys, precipitation hardened stainless steels, alloy steels for critical applications in auto sector. Next, please. Next. Now, in the PLI draft scheme, as I mentioned, in alloy steel products, only three varieties are mentioned at the bottom: tool and die steel, valve steel, and bearing steel. Now, most of the specialty steel products are totally missed out. Next, please. Similarly, the rate of PLI, as I mentioned, these are very critical technologically incentives which requires high value of working, but then the incentive amount is just 9%. These are the products which require much larger incentives so that these can be promoted, they can be competitive against imports. And since the market is not mature in the country, the requirements are very, very small. If they are incentivized, people will be able to produce and cater to the small requirements of the domestic user. Next. Similarly, you know, these are the steels which are required in small quantities, but 25% increase unless the Gaganyaan or Chandrayaan, their requirement goes up by 25%, or in the defense, the requirement goes up by more than 25%, this demand is not going to increase. So here they have to be really supported, and the demand is dependent largely by the public sector, by the government, because they are consumed by the defense sector, they are consumed by the space sector, aerospace at all, which is largely in public sector. So 25% growth rate in this is highly displaced, as against 5-6% and literally color coated or some of the commodity steels. Next. Then we have some of the suggestions, like in alloy steel products, we would request to include various other products which are not included, like remelted steel, precipitation hardened stainless steel, super alloys, and alloy steel for critical applications in auto sector. So this we have mentioned, and we have mentioned some outlay for the incentives also. Next. Similarly, the incentive amount. Here the incentive amount requirement is much larger, as we are just not competitive, that's why they are getting imported. Now, it's not the commodity products. Here, it's a very critical, very large working is required to be done, very large investment is there per unit of production. So the incentive amount has to be much larger, but it can be phased out over a period of time once the development takes place. Next. Similarly, the threshold limits threshold limits for minimum incremental production is 25%. Now, it can't be that way. It has to be much lower so that people become eligible to get the incentive. If it is 25%, people will not be eligible for that. Next. Now, another thing over and above this, One of the things which is mentioned that all the facilities are required to be in-house. Now we need to understand that in these specialty steels, the customization levels are very high. Besides producing steel, the customer wants forging, a wire rod rolling, machined die blocks, deep hole drilling is required, various large variety of heat treatments are required. So fairly large amount of subsequent to steel manufacturing working is required, and all these facilities need not be, cannot be in-house. So certain amount of job work should be permitted after the steel is produced. So that is another request for change in the eligibility for the policy. Next. Next. Another very important thing is, now this sector has to upgrade itself. It has to spend a lot of amount on the research and development. So it has to be incentivized for R&D activities. And until unless it is done, then the new developments will not take place. While the rest of the industry is quite mature, their plants which are producing from few million ton to almost 15-20 million tons, here the total requirement is very small, the total production is very small, and the new developments, requirement for new developments is fairly large. So this need to be incentivized by way of funding towards R&D. Next. So just to summarize, especially steel sub-segments to be added in alloy steel category and incentive outlay to be redistributed, rate of PLI to be increased for alloy steels, minimum incremental production for alloy steel should be 6%, and allow all specialty steel producers having BOF, EOF or EF melting facility to be eligible for PLI scheme, and R&D funding of up to 100 crore for each of the specialty steel manufacturers. Next. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Goyal. It was indeed quite insightful to understand the entire process of, you know, producing specialty steel, and especially the distinction between, you know, the specialty steel and the crude steel process and as a product. And you also highlighted the applications, especially in certain strategic sectors like space, defense, aerospace, etc. So, I mean, all the points are very well taken, sir, and especially specific suggestions on what kind of products should be included in the target segment or the target products. Also, certain, you know, suggestions on thresholds and rationalizing the thresholds further. They all are, you know, very well received and shall be recorded and passed on to the Ministry of Steel. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you for your insights. With this, may I now request our next speaker, Mr. Pankaj Satija, Chief Regulatory Affairs from Tata Steel. Mr. Pankaj Satija. Yeah. So over to you, Mr. Pankaj.
Yeah. Hello.
Yes, you are audible, sir. Yes, but voice is breaking. Yes, you are audible.
So, and to all the PIB 11, but and it mentioned that the Union Cabinet shared 11 details in the end of the enhancing the concern in policy and the trade exports. So the question here is, are two enhancing as capable capturing and enhancing exports? Are they going to fulfill that, or is it only the one? I mean, India is uniquely placed for this because of raw material, iron, which is good availability. Second, the market availability will consume or country in the world is as in that it should have any depending on the problem of it happening.
Mr. Pankaj, just sorry to interrupt.
I think we can hardly make out what he's saying.
Hello?
Yeah, Pankaj, sir, your voice is not clear. Can you switch off your camera so that audio can be. Sir, your voice is fluctuating. So can you switch off your camera? Yes, we can hear you now, sir. Please go ahead.
Now, you talk. Okay, fine. So what saying that the objective of PLI was to improve the manufacturing capabilities as well as export. And in that case, we need to see whether to fulfill those objectives or is it the only thing which can fulfill. The second part is, which I was mentioning, that India uniquely placed in terms of availability of raw material, whether it is iron ore and coal, and availability of market is, which makes India unique in among the world in the different countries. And in that scenario, should not be removing the shackles or the bottlenecks or the barriers which Indian steel industry is facing. We all know that the disability to Indian industry is close to the tune of $80 in terms of taxation or in terms of logistics challenges. So the background for PLI, which was meant for Atmanirbhar Bharat on export and imports, and whether this will also enhance or improve or attract the foreign investment, that also has to be seen. So first of all, we need to understand what for this objective was meant. Was it for organic and inorganic growth to be given a boost to attract further FDI, or to make import substitution, make export enhancement? And given that background, whatever information we are having, it's like the four types of steel which have been covered, like color coated high strength steel, alloy bars, rods and railheads, and the different ceilings, is it going to meet those import substitution? So there has been always a debate that it is more on coated steel and not on other parts of the steel which we are thinking of. The second part which Mr. Goyal has very well mentioned, that end to end. So what is going to be the end to end? It is going only to the big manufacturers, or will it encompass the various MSMEs and the smaller player also, or the secondary sector? And second, the important part is, which also was slightly stressed upon, that what should have been the eligibility criteria, whether it is on import substitution or investment in our employment. These analysis has to come out very well, which is not so clear in public domain, whatever we know. And until the draft is out and the stakeholder consultations are done, I doubt it would be able to meet its own objective. Because still people are not very clear whether it is on the incremental investment or incremental production, though they have tried to put the baseline FY 19, 20, not 2021, because it's an exceptional year of COVID. The third aspect, which is also very important, is the longer gestation period. So steel is not comparable to the assembly line of mobile. And in that case, if we all know that environmental clearance and all those things will takes more than 2 to 3 years. So this 5 years time horizon, how far it is good, or should it be taken from the back end, those who have started? But then again, it will be seen in a different light, that maybe some of the companies would have influenced, it may look like. So this gestation period and the increasing the time horizon also is an important area. And as we've discussed, the production, sales, R&D, investment also should be taken into the consideration. And then what happens if it is not being utilized in one particular year? It may spill over to the different sectors or different year or other gestation period. So the clear definitions of the covered product also need to be come out very clearly if we what we meant by quoted products and all those things. And quantum incentives, which we had discussed, As we know that the huge cost disadvantage Indian steel industry is facing $8,200. So the incentives of 3% or 6%, it should be quite good enough to attract the investment in the requisite grades. So for each grade, like see, 6,322 crores have been allocated, but how we in the dynamics of demand and supply has to be seen. The next important part is the PLI scheme as a standalone, how it can be linked with the different schemes which government is trying to bring, like Purvodaya scheme or the steel clusters or infrastructure push. So it cannot be a standalone working on different form. It has to be synced with the different schemes and other programs of the government. The next part which I want to mention here is the implementation will be the key for such schemes, how the transparency and the procedures, the benefit availing is inculcated, that will also a very important thing. So my request to the government will be that the scheme should be made public for the stakeholder consultation, so we can draw the inputs from the sectors and then probably it should encompass all the players of the sector. It should not be linked to, as it was mentioned, one of the articles that it is 100 crore per limit is there, and how we can take care of the other sectors, that also has to be seen. Then government also needs to work out on ease of business, especially relative infrastructure, land and entrepreneurship to further lower the cost and facilitate those investments who wants to PLI and wants to avail the schemes. So these are some of my quick points, and thank you very much for giving this opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Pankaj. I mean, you indeed highlighted the fact that in India obviously enjoys a natural advantage in that sense in steel production. Some of the factors obviously tend to favor India as a destination. And this PLI, in fact, is a good favorable policy instrument which government plans to formulate to address the cost disadvantage which you had highlighted. However, in the draft there is certain clarity required on the guidelines on the implementation mechanism. So all the suggestions are very well received and captured. And also you highlighted the fact that In addition to the PLI and fiscal incentives, it is what is important is the ease of doing business and you know how in general the regulatory burden is rationalized and reduced in the sector. So thanks a lot for your suggestion, sir. So with this now, may I now request Mr. M.K. Gupta from Starwire as our next speaker
He is yet to join. He got delayed in another meeting. He will join maybe another 15 minutes. You can request Mr. Sarad now.
Sure, no problem. Yeah, Mr. Sharad from JSW, sir, over to you.
Yeah, thank Mr. Maheshwari. And in fact, my very special thanks to SOCHM for organizing this discussion on this very important topic. I think which in terms of value, I will say is limited, seeing the size of the industry and the investment required to increase the capacity addition. But I think it's going to set the direction for the industry, especially in these tested times by this government initiative. And in fact, I heard the earlier speakers, my thanks to Mr. Goyal, Mr. Satija, for giving the insights. Major points have already been covered. Mr. Goyal also covered in detail the importance of this scheme, and before the scheme is announced, it is to be definitely further reviewed, studied, and the feedback and the views from the stakeholders is to be taken to really to get the advantage of this. In fact, we have to understand before I go into the details that what is the objective of this scheme being thought of by Government of India, which they are going to announce now. We have been hearing last one and a half years very, very loudly, 2 years, that Atmanirbhar Bharat and all. But I think these kind of action, many earlier actions also have clearly demonstrated the intent of the government to really actually do the things on ground, not just the words. And this is one great initiative which has been taken. Because the ultimate objectives are what? The investments, which leads to capability building, so that country not only takes care of the domestic requirement, but also becomes competitive in terms of the capability globally. Reduced import dependability means it results in direct forex savings. Increasing the export capability, globally competitive means forex earnings. So all these points I feel are extremely important, and this step is in the direction to actually enable the things to happen. But now going specifically into maybe one or two subsections of the scheme, which I feel maybe kindly to be represented also to the Government of India, we have to understand. I will be maybe speaking a slightly more, Goel Saab has touched upon a speciality steel. I will also talk about the speciality in terms of that is, of course, what he has shown, the pictures are real speciality, very well accepted without any doubts by, I think, all members and all the persons attending this meet. But for us also, we have to understand the requirement of the steel in the country is various sectors. The speciality is one, which in terms of value-wise, extremely high, but volume-wise, of course, limited because of the limited usage. But keeping in mind that if we see the per capita consumption of steel, we all know close to maybe 74, 75 kg. And when we come to coated steel, it is only about 7 kg as compared to China's 33 kg, 34 kg. So there lies a huge scope, and with the country developing, urbanization happening at a fast rate and has to continue, these things, value-added steel also, when we call off not only just producing a commodity-grade hot-rolled coil, also maybe whether it is galvanized, galvalume, galvanneal, or color-coated steel. So all these things in the entire value chain needs investments, and out of which color-coated also is one of the area which is in the entire value chain. You will say that this is one of the top end of the value chain, leading to maximum investment from steel making to iron making to steel making, hot rolled, cold rolled, galvanized, galvalume, and color coating. So that kind of investment which is required is extremely high to complete the value chain and reach to the top. So, but yes, it leads to employment also. It requires some speciality steel production in terms of taking care of the requirements of some of the sectors. For example, I'll give few examples wherein we have started seeing the change is the automobile industry, depending on the coated products, majorly on imports till few years back. Similarly, the appliance industries is still a large portion of that continues to be imported, but a significant portion has got shifted to domestic, but it's still a long march to replace the imports, which needs very, very special steel in terms of investments, making it capable to meet the highly demanding automobile and or appliance industry requirements. Even if we see solar industry, which is India has a certain targets given for that, what is going to be the renewable energy capacity addition. Solar energy, we see maybe till 2 years back, there was most of the import was coming to meet the requirement of that kind of grade of steel which is required, because this is a product which is an external environment and needs a life of 25 years. So that kind of product was majorly coming from Korea, but now I'm happy to tell the members present here that maybe almost more than 90% of the steel is being catered by the domestic steel industry led by us, JSW. So these all have required investments, and we continue to do that. But coming to the allocation of the scheme, there are only 2-3 points which I will like to say. As Mr. Goel said about the from 9%, which is the highest, fortunately, in the scheme draft which we have seen, to be 25%, it is purely because the volumes are low, investments are high. Similarly, if you see in terms of, it is the other way around, the approach which has been taken in the draft, that if we talk of coated, overall coated average is 3.9%. And the highest value added, which needs to reach up to that value chain, because it's the scheme is for integrated steel players, the highest value chain which needs the highest investment to reach up to that is the color coated. There it is only 3%. In value terms, it looks high, maybe 800 odd crores, because the product cost is high. So I think the 3% criteria for color coated or 3.9% average for coated products is something I think which needs to be relooked, because it needs, it should not be seen from value and arriving at a number out of the kitty of 6,000 odd crores, whatever the scheme amount is. I think it is important to see what is the criteria of the scheme, the objective of the scheme, of investments, of capability building, of employment, import replacement, export increase, all these factors, which investment is contributing how much, maybe weightage can be given to these factors, which ultimately the objective of the Government of India is, and then decide on that what kind of allocation should be given to which subsection among the entire steel chain, which has been considered for this incentive. Not only just this, deciding abruptly that value I have decided on the top line, because that value doesn't carry any meaning, because if I stop at galvanized, then I am getting maybe or galvalume or galvanil, I am getting 3% without investing incremental amount for color coated. So I, on my investment, I get that. But investing even much higher is something, and then also getting the same will be, I think some relook into this can definitely motivate the industry to go for up to the end, highest point of value chain. And one more point which has been touched upon by earlier speaker also, Pankaj, that steel industry, that 5-year period, I'm not doubting on the 5-year period if it has been said, but the end point and the start point needs to be relooked. If suppose, hypothetically, if I assume that the scheme is from 1st of April 2021 and ends 5 years later, entire process to prepare the project, to invest, to set the line and then start producing incremental volumes, whatever the scheme demands, is going to be a challenge. Either the start period is earlier, 3 year, 2 year, 4 year, whatever is decided, or investment made in maybe next 2 years, 3 years, and then next block of 5 years. Otherwise, to getting the benefit or utilizing the scheme amount, though the amount is significantly small, I will say, but then also utilizing this will be a challenge because of the high gestation period. These two points definitely need to be relooked to make the scheme successful. But once again, I will say that this is definitely something which the industry is looking upon, and we are quite confident that earlier the scheme is announced, industry can plan in terms of investments, capability building, and making the objective of employment and other factors happen fast on ground. That's all from my side. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Manish.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. It was insightful. And the fact that you said that it is, in fact, one of the most tangible steps Government of India has taken to make, you know, make it towards Atmanirbhar in steel sector, and especially the emphasis on coated steel product and the way it has to be dealt in this PLI scheme is obviously very well received. And the fact that the time period is something which government probably can relook at, given the long gestation period of investments. So what should be that 5-year block, you know, when it should be starting? So definitely point very well taken. And the suggestions shall be obviously shared with the ministry. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you.
Kanishk, now we can invite R.V. Sridharja ji.
Sure. So with this, may I
now request our next speaker, R.V. Sridharja, to share his.
Yeah. Good afternoon to everyone, and thanks to Kanishk and others from SOCHAM for inviting me to speak. This is a game changer of announcement, or should I say initiative, which the Government of India has taken. There are many other initiatives which the Modi government has taken. Just to give you an example, 111 million toilets have been constructed all over the country in the last 1.5 years. This is a big demand booster for color coated. In fact, I am handling the coated section of ArcelorMittal Nippon Steel. So it has generated a lot of demand. Then again, there are many other initiatives like, railway stations replacing the asbestos sheets with, the color-coated steels. And then building this, Nitin Gadkari has been building this highways at 41 kilometers per day basis at the frantic space. At every 5 kilometers, we have a petrol pump kiosk and so on and so forth. All this needs a lot of coated steel, and this is a big demand booster for steel. So in line with all those earlier initiatives, this also is an initiative which is a game changer. Few things, you know, ArcelorMittal produces the entire range, flat products, and then, you know, it goes to the highest level, which is color coated and galvanized and all that. 38% is for all this high strength steels and all that, like API 652, high tensile hot roll coils, you know, slits, sheets and plates, auto grade, boiler quality, quench and tempered. ArcelorMittal has one of the largest plate mills in the country. So all these constitute about, 38% of the scheme out of the 6,300 crores. 2,400 crores is allocated for this high strength steels. And government, in a way, is incentivizing exports and disincentivizing imports as a part of this Atmanirbhar Bharat. We are told that the current demand for high-strength steels in the country, 85% of the domestic production is only catering to 85% of the total demand for high-strength steels. And the demand at this point of time is about 7.6 million tons. And this is likely to go, and 20% of whatever the demand is catered to by imports. In 2026, 5 years from now, there is the initiative is to reduce the imports from 20% of the current consumption in India to 2%, and exports, which at this point of time is 572,000 tons, to make it to thrice of what it is being done now. Let's say about 1.6 million tons. So disincentivizing imports and incentivizing exports, these are some of the things, and overall increasing the production. The current production at this point of time is 7.6 million tons, and in 5 years' time it is expected to be close to 16.7 or 17 million tons. So basically you are incentivizing the overall production of high-strength steels. Then the next category in this special steels is coated steel, which is about 34%, and about 2,100 crores is allocated for this. As one of the as one of our earlier speakers has mentioned, the incentive for production incentive is only 3% for coated products. However, there is this 6% slab and 9% slab as well. 6% slab is for tin plate, electro galvanized, etc., etc., and 9% is for import substitution. Now, there is a lot of refrigerator doors and all which are being imported, the steel for that which is imported in the country. And now there is a fillip to production of these grades in India. So this sort of production incentive, which is the highest, which is giving 9% for import substitution, will certainly incentivize production in these grades. And ArcelorMittal Nippon Steel is in the forefront of all this. We are taking a giant leap in all this washing machines and so on and so forth, refrigerators, this sort of appliance grade steel. At this point of time, the total demand for appliance grade and OEMs, high-end OEMs, critical OEMs, is about 420,000 tons per annum. And this is growing at the rate of 20%. So all this will be incentivized thanks to these schemes. Even if this scheme was not there, it would have gone ahead, but now it has gathered space thanks to whatever this is there. Then one of the things which as a feedback for improvement is this, that among all the products, the highest sort of PLI payment, PLI payout to the industry as a percentage of investment, is the highest in rails, is the highest in alloy, and incidentally the lowest in the coated products. So this needs a relook, because as we see, all of these 22 million houses are going to be constructed by 2022 or 2023. It requires a lot of galvanized steel. So all these government schemes have to be catered to by increased production of galvanized and color-coated, etc. And then again, India has grain silos in a big way. In our country, about 10 to 12 million tons of grain, food grains, rot every year. Now, if we have to prevent this rotting of it and incentivize production, etc., we need to have grain silos, so which will prolong the life of food grains and all. So all this requires a high duty, heavy duty galvanized 500 grams, 600 grams coatings and all that. So all this incentive is required, which to an extent from this scheme we can get it. Apart from whatever I've said, there are general improvements as well. As some of our earlier speakers have said, this 5 years window is too limited. Most of the projects require a lot of government approval, environmental clearances, the long gestation period and all that. So 5 years may not be enough. Maybe we can start, the government should look at this 5 years after the completion of the project, only for the implementation, for the you know, taking it to final conclusion after the project is implemented. I think 5 years should apply from then onwards. Then again, this threshold of 10% incremental production may not be incentivizing enough. Many of us may not be able to meet it. So can we look at 5%? So this is one idea. Then the third point is, we need to have an MOU, detailed MOU with Government of India for 5 years, and we have to lay down all our plans. If there is any mishap or any faltering in these, we have agreed, the initiatives that we have agreed with the government, all these incentives will be withdrawn. There is a lot of complexity in this. Can we not make it simple like it's in China? You know, most of the government incentives which are given in China are very simple. Let's not make it too complex. Then this end-to-end manufacturing. Suppose if I want to do conversion, you know, many of the entire gamma we may not be able to produce. We need to do some conversion, like for example, tin plate, ArcelorMittal does not manufacture, in India, or electro-galvanize. Can we send outside, get it converted, and as we call it, anchor and the ancillary? Can whatever the ancillary does, can it be clubbed as a part of production and looked at incentive? End-to-end would encompass even the ancillary units as well. And then again, from this scheme, only the primary steel producers are being incentivized. What about the secondary producers? Those who do not have hot roll coils, those who do not have cold roll coils and all that. I mean, so if we have to incentivize production in the secondary sector also, this end-to-end requirement, integrated supplies and all that, needs to be removed. Otherwise, you are only incentivizing the primary steel producers. Of course, we are a primary steel producer, but we would also look at secondary steel producers being incentivized as well. Then this scoring and rating, sort of criteria and all that. It says you cannot displace your product, displacement of production. So if I am producing high-end value steel, obviously I'll be producing less of the lower-end steel. I mean, if my the universe of my production is what it is, it's limited, I will be substituting the low-end with the high-end. But then that is not allowed. That displacement is not allowed. So this is something which should be looked at. Then what is the definition of R&D? R&D, what sort of expenses should be included in R&D, you know? So all these things should be looked at. And these are some of my thoughts, and I will leave it at that.
Sure. Thanks a lot.
Okay. So I think thanks a lot, sir. Indeed, your suggestions on bringing more clarity on the guidelines, especially the definition of end to end, and the fact that it tends to put probably the secondary steel manufacturers slightly at a disadvantageous position from that context. Then rationalizing the thresholds, and once again, you also emphasize the point on the 5 year period. So clearly this emerges as a common requirement or a concern in the policy draft, and also the fact that especially high tension steel needs more focus in the scheme. So thanks a lot, sir. All the suggestions are very well received. Thank you. Okay, so with this, now may I request Mr. M.K. Gupta from Starwire to share his thoughts and opinion on the scheme, please. Mr. M.K. Gupta?
Yeah, am I audible? Yeah, well, good afternoon, everybody. I am Mahendra Gupta. I am Managing Director, Starwire India Limited. I am also chairing Steel Furnace Association of India and also chairing PhD Chamber of Commerce, Defense and Homeland Security Committee. Our company is engaged in the manufacturing of special steel products in the form of rolled products, castings, forgings, Getting to the requirements of automobile engine valve steel, nuclear plants, thermal plants, gas turbines, aerospace industry and defense industry, tool and die steel, and high-speed steel for engineering application. First of all, I would like to thank SOCHEM for giving me this opportunity for expressing my views on production-linked incentive scheme for specialty steel in this stakeholders consultation seminar. I also thank profusely Steel Ministry for taking bold initiatives in controlling import and promoting domestic specialty steel production in the recent few years. I would like to congratulate the government on announcing the PLI scheme for specialty steel sector. We are hopeful that the initiative will be instrumental in providing the much needed thrust in the sector, in boosting domestic steel capabilities and raising its share in the global supply chain. We also see this initiative as a tool that will eventually bridge the technology and the infrastructure related gap in the sector. With this view, I would like to put forth the key recommendations for the government's consideration while drafting the scheme, finalizing the scheme to ensure the holistic development of the sector. Inclusion of target products in the scheme having strategic importance. Introducing the following segment in the list of beneficiary target segments in the alloy steel products: high speed steel. Again, a lot of imports are happening. Super alloys made of nickel based, cobalt based, and iron based. Titanium alloys. Alloy steel including armor steel, specialty steel, and very high grades of specialty steel for defense and aerospace sector. These products are critical to be included as they supply products to India's other critical sectors such as aerospace and defense. Augmenting the production capacities of these products will also benefit other allied sectors and will contribute significantly to achieve substitution of imports in these sectors. Clear categorization of segments. Categorization of specialty steel, namely high-speed steel, super alloys based of nickel, cobalt, iron, titanium alloys, alloy steel including armor and other defense-grade steels. This is very, very important. It is pertinent to understand that the investment capabilities will significantly vary for both type of players. For above sector, to ensure coverage of specialty steel players in the scheme, government may consider categorizing the specialty steel producer in eligibility criteria, growth percentage, incentive budget for this segment separately. Let me share this some information on Chinese specialty steel by their government to exporters. Government of China gives 13% incentive on all specialty steel exports to their domestic manufacturer. Hence, we request the government to consider the request for categorizing the segments as above. We also request to earmark at least 1500 crores out of 6400 crores for this sector only. Expanding the benefit coverage, setting lower incentive limits for each company per company to ensure benefits coverage for more company oblique players under the scheme, and the incentives are not limited to a few companies. For example, the maximum incentive ceiling per company may be considered as 50 crores to bring more companies under the gambit of PLI scheme. It is kindly requested to consider the request for limiting the incentive per company to ensure maximum coverage. Standardization of requirements to encourage industry participation. Since specialty steel is not producing in bulk quantity, it takes a lot of time for approvals, homologations by OEMs. It is requested to standardize the threshold of year-on-year growth as 10% for all products categories covered in the scheme. It will enable more participation and ensure easier implementation of the scheme. Now, the recently announcement on 24th of December 2020, Steel Ministry have further brought many grades of tool steel, die steel, high-speed steel, valve steel, and many other grades under quality control order, hereby restricting the substandard and uncontrolled imports in the country. Recently, about a year and a half back, a committee was formed by earlier Secretary of Defense Production in December 2019 for identifying the critical and strategic raw material in defense manufacturing. Committee was headed by Dr. Jha, currently Chairman Midhani. I believe he is also one of the eminent panelists in this consultation committee also, and other officials from Ministry of Defense. I was also a part of this committee. This committee submitted this report in March 2020, before lockdown, to Secretary DP Shri Rajkumarji. Let me share some findings of this committee. Just first slide, please. Global demand for aerospace. Yeah. So you will find that this is for defense and aerospace materials. So you will find that almost 81% is the quantity specialty steel share in the global demand for defense and aerospace materials. And in value wise, it is 56% share. Now, next, I'll just explain more about the super alloys. Super alloys are a group of alloys comprising of nickel, cobalt, and iron, along with other refractory metals, to maintain high strength even at high temperature with high corrosion resistance. Super alloys are mainly used in aerospace, gas turbine engines, nuclear reactors, and rocket engines. Although manufacturing capabilities exist within country, which includes Medhani and private sector, import is done in large quantity through OEMs approved vendors in the form of various components and raw materials. This is due to licensed production of equipment under TOT, conditional warranty, non-availability of certification, economies of scale, lack of design data and specification of validity, validation of material, etc. I'll just show you the next slides shows almost 1500 crores worth. Yeah, the last slide, please. Last, earlier one, please. Super alloys, please. Yeah, that's right. 1500 crores almost worth are being imported every year. Next is titanium alloys. Titanium alloys are used in both airframe structures and jet engine components due to moderate weight, high structural properties, excellent corrosion resistant. So I would strongly recommend that this data, the next slide, please. Import data, almost 504 to 500 crore rupees of imports are happening every year. Alloy steel, including armor, specialty steel, and exotic stainless steel. Though India is second largest producer of steel globally, it is still a net importer of exotic stainless steel and alloy steel used in high-end application like defense, aerospace, and space, and aeronautical grades. The country is dependent on import of most of the super duplex, super austenitic, and high alloyed variety of stainless steel for critical and strategic end use applications. So next slide, please. The next slide, yeah, it shows around 3500 crore rupees or 5000 last year, like 1819 it was 5, but then this 1920 is partly up to November. So around 5000 crores worth materials are being imported in the country in the various forms. So I would request Steel Ministry to bring defense and aerospace grades in all kinds of specialty steel, titanium alloys, and alloy steel under steel screening committee to put embargo on such grades, steel imports in phased manner. All the foreign OEMs and Indian OEMs, including defense PSUs, are importing very heavily all such grades, which need to be stopped in phased manner to make Atmanirbhar Bharat successful and also to give impetus to Make in India and Vocal for Local movement started by Shri Narendra Modi ji, our Honorable Prime Minister. Thank you very much for patience. Thank you. Over to you, Kanish.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. And your address and a brief presentation brought a lot of focus and emphasis, speciality on, especially on, the application in defense and aerospace and the fact that super alloys is still being imported considerably in the country. And the fact that it has an application on certain strategic sectors like aerospace, defense, and such high-end sectors. For Ministry of Steel, it can be a wonderful opportunity to address this requirement and use PLI as a measure to basically bring import substitution in this segment as well. So points very well taken, sir. Thanks a lot. They'll be duly captured and shared with the ministry. Yeah, with this may I now request Mr. Saurabh Agarwal from Ernst & Young for his address and views on so ENY happened to be my last employer, in one of my last employers as well, so good to connect with you, Saurabh, on the forum.
Thank you, Kanish. Thank you, everyone, for giving the opportunity to ENY to present our thoughts on the PLI scheme for steel. I request if I can get the sharing rights to present my presentation. That will be really kind.
Naik, can you help?
Sure, I'm doing it. Now you got it.
Sure, thanks.
Sure, thank you.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is frozen now. I think it is coming up. Right. Yes, now you can go ahead.
Okay. So at least as EY and as Saurabh Agarwal, I have been working on multiple PLI schemes and with multiple industry associations. I just want to lay down certain things. What is the thought process of the government behind PLI schemes? Of course, as my colleague panelists talked about, the thought process is import substitution and focus on exports. Of course, import substitution is one of the key elements to make Bharat Atmanirbhar or to make Bharat self-reliant per se. Before even we move towards exports or we move towards making India the manufacturing hub for the world market, the total outlay for the scheme is 6,322 crores. I generally hear from all the industry associations where all members wants that some part of this pie should be shared with everyone. See, India overall has been witnessing a equality and they are, or whatever are the incentives of the government, whether under the erstwhile MEIS scheme or other incentives, are divided equally amongst all the players in the industry. The thought process of the government is changing a bit over here. Now the government is thinking and they're looking at how China developed, how Korea developed as a manufacturing hub. They're looking at a fact that over there, the incentives were given to mega players to make them develop into a mega industry. And of course, to support those mega industries, automatically the ripple effect of the same has been seen in the economy in the form of various small players also growing along with them. So intent of the government under the PLI schemes, be it any PLI scheme, is very clear to give it to certain restricted players so that they get sufficient quantum of money from the PLI scheme to improve their IRR or to make their products competitive in the world as well as Indian market. Saying so, broadly, three types of rates we are hearing from the industry. 3%, 6% and 9% rate being allocated to various grades of steel. Of course, that's there on the screen. Anyone can can have a look at it. The important point is that the government is considering the scheme to start from FY21-22 and to end on FY25-26. I think I heard my co-panelists also talking about it. Any project to develop, and there will always be a gestation period if there is a new investment which is required under this, which means that new investment, it will the project will do a DOCP or a date of commercial production broadly after 2 years to 3 years from the date when they get the sanction order under this, which in turn means that there should be a block of 5 years which should be available over, say, a period of next 8 years should be given, wherein a industrialist should be allowed to choose the block of 5 years. This is a ground level reality that it takes time to set up a factory and thereafter to make it operational. And then you are giving me the incentives on the incremental sales. Of course, this can be beneficial for those who have an idle capacity lying with them. But in case you are linking it to the investment and you are saying that you will give the benefit to, or you will allow the scheme to those people who in turn commit for the highest investments, etc., then in such cases, there should be a block period which should be allowed. Further, when we talk about this scheme, what we are also hearing is that the sanction order which will come, there will be a weighted averages which will be assigned in this. How much is the incremental sales you are committing, whether domestic or exports? What is the incremental investment you are committing? What is the R&D you are committing? And thereafter, the last one, are you ensuring that your current product line continues as such and you're not just merely changing your product? So there are four types of weights will be assigned, depending on which you will have to file the application. And you have to be cautious about those weights. Of course, each of these, you can say, criteria which I talked about will have a specified weight under the policies. Saying so, if we see the mobile scheme, many people applied out of, say, 16 odd applicants, 10 people got the benefit of the mobile scheme or 11 people got it. For medical API scheme, around 218 applications have been filed by broadly 80 odd players. Let's see the final fate as to what the scheme comes across as and how many people get eligible under the said scheme. Similarly, on the medical device front, 28 applications were filed by around 21 odd applicants. So the scheme will be limited. The intent is to give the benefit to those players who are committing the largest investment. Investment means in turn the employment will also happen in the country. Saying so, it is not just merely PLI scheme which the industry should look at. PLI is a central government scheme They are granting incentives, and of course, PLI is the buzz of the day today. There are multiple schemes of central government as well as the state government also. Many a times industry do miss those schemes. One is the state incentives. Of course, state incentives are defined in the policy. When we talk about, and each state today in India, because we are in a federal structure, each state is competing with each other to get the investments into their state. Therefore, it becomes important for the industry to look into the various policies of the state governments and see which state is offering the best incentive. And of course, do the negotiations also with the state government when you are setting up a plan. Generally, what I've seen in those cases, and when I talk to my clients, I generally feel that they are the important thing which gets missed is the negotiation part. You go by what is written in the policy rather than looking into what other state governments are offering or what the same state government has offered to a similar size of project. Last but not the least, the mover scheme, which is called as Manufacturing and Other Operations in Bonded Warehouse Regulation Scheme 2019. This is another scheme of central government on the customs front, wherein they are deferring the duty on capital goods. In case you are setting up a plant, etc., you can go under this scheme and you are not required to pay the duty and GST upfront. The duty deferment happens for a period of almost the life of the capital goods. If you sell the capital goods post their life period as a scrap in the domestic market, you will be required to pay the duty. If you sell the scrap or if you export the goods outside India, you are not required to pay any duty. Saying so, there are multiple combinations of schemes which should be looked at. I personally believe that it's a great initiative by the government to come up with such a PLI scheme and allow incentives to the industry in these tough times. In my view, it's like a financial stimulus being granted subject to certain conditions. And knowing in a country like India, where the revenue exchequers are decreasing as of now, there are a lot of expenditure which they have to do. Allocating around 1.45 lakh crores towards the 10 sectors has been a great thing done by the government. And of course, it will lead to manufacturing of some specialty grade steel into the country. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Saurabh. And the fact that you highlighted, government's focus on is slightly changing from some of the past incentive schemes, wherein there was this principle of equality. While here, not just steel, probably in all the other sectors, idea is to identify select champions and hope for a ripple effect, which probably, similar to what had happened in countries like China or South Korea. And also you highlighted the fact that yes, PLI is definitely a policy instrument, which is the buzzword, but it is equally important to analyze and understand the state's incentive schemes, because obviously, today each and every state is doling out a lot of aggressive fiscal incentives to attract investments. So they all, both should be coupled together, and all investors should try and analyze both the things in detail and in parallel. So thanks a lot. So I think with this, Nahid, we are done with the all the panelists. May I may I now then ask certain questions to the panelists, if that is okay?
Yes, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Sure. So in fact, my first question would be actually to Mr. Saurabh only from EY. The fact that, yes, is Saurabh still there?
Yeah, I'm very much there. Ganesh, go ahead.
Okay, great. So the fact that, yes, you highlighted the principle of identifying champions. And steel is, in fact, a very peculiar sector, wherein, one of the co-panelists, from ArcelorMittal, he highlighted that there's a primary steel manufacturer and there's a secondary steel manufacturer. So while yes, government is definitely right in that sense, and in the approach and taking the approach to identify champions, but probably in steel there are two different categories of manufacturers in the country. Players who are exclusively into primary and probably to some extent in certain low-grade commodity steel manufacturing when we talk of specialty, and there are certain secondary manufacturers who are exclusively into high-grade steel and some. So the champions can be different. Now, my short point is champions for all these two categories will be very, very different in their scale, in their, you know, the way they will manufacture processes, cost structures, etc. So what is your suggestion, you know, keeping this in view to the government?
So two, 3 points, if you see, and government is rightly addressing it. If you see, India is one of the largest exporter of steel today. But if we see what is our per ton price in the market, it is around 600 to 800 per ton, which means that we are not producing the high grade specialty steel or high grade steels, which are currently is a market captured by, say, China or Korea, where the selling price comes somewhere closer to 2000 to 2500 per ton, which in turn means that these are high technology industries where the focus should lie in. 600 to 800 per ton, we are exporting like anything. Even if you see today, the total number of import done by the Indian steel industry, Indian steel, total import which is coming in the steel sector vis-a-vis export, broadly, there is not much of a difference. There might be a difference of maybe not much, maybe 10% of the, you can say, imports are higher as compared to the exports volume. So overall, the thrust should be to give it to those type of steel where the production is not happening in the country today, and we are relying upon other countries for those supplies. And of course, there should be a higher budget allocation also towards the same, so that industries get incentivized and they set up the shop in India for such grade of high steel. Because otherwise, what will keep on happening is, if you do try the equal distribution, like it happens in the past also, everyone will get small part of it, and the IRR on the project or even the pricing will not be competitive for the Indian players or the Indian manufacturers to get into or even to sell their product in the Indian market, leave apart going to the world market. So I think they are doing right that giving the highest incentive to the high grade steels, and then of course 3% allocated towards those particular projects or those particular grade of steels where the exports are happening. And of course, with the MEIS scheme getting phased out and RodTEP scheme coming into picture, where the RodTEP rate might be somewhere 0.8 to 1.5% compared to MEIS being offered at 3%. So there is a delta, so which they are trying to fill that particular gap through a 3% scheme for other exporters. So I think it's a right direction. Of course, the ask of the industry can be 9%, 25% as the case may be, but it will depend upon what the exchequer is available with the government.
Yeah, sure. Thanks a lot, Saurabh. So my next question is to Mr. R.K. Goyal from Kalyani Steel. So, sir, obviously you highlighted that, yes, PLI is definitely a wonderful, fantastic policy instrument government is coming up with. But there's equally, you know, important focus to be given on R&D, especially in specialty steel sector. And the fact that Ministry of Steel has undertaken various initiatives to, you know, towards boosting, augmenting R&D capacity in the country. And I think they have constituted a steel development fund as well. So in view of, you know, considering specialty steel as a subsector, what will be your suggestion towards, you know, utilizing the funds available in steel development fund towards better, towards focus towards this specialty steel sector especially?
Thank you for asking this question. You know, historically in our country, government has given incentives in terms of like tax incentives, like if you invest in R&D, you get 200% as depreciation and all. By this, a major investment has not happened. Except I'm not talking of all the companies, but generally in the medium-sized steel industry and all. While we have seen abroad, whether it is in China, whether it is in Europe, fairly large integrated R&D facilities are available, where all the facilities are there, starting from burden preparation, beneficiation plant, sinter plant, blast furnace, then steel melt shop, rolling, forging, all sort of facilities in one location or two location, it is there. And people can carry out their research, their development of various products, various experimentation they can do. And at the same time, the company which is having this R&D facility, they are doing it for the industry. Now, in India, we do not find any such facility. If a steel development fund can create a very large such facility where you can give them an assignment, you can carry out experiments yourself, can test your products yourself, so much large without investing very large amount in the capex. You can do experimentation, you can develop either raw materials, you can utilize local raw materials or develop particular products and then commercialize in your own setup. So this will really help. And this is the way China has developed a technology for, like, today they are among the best in iron making. You find there are several facilities there, basically just purely iron making, R&D facilities for iron making, whether it is blast furnace, whether it is sinter, or whether it is coke oven. So there are design institutes which are exclusively doing this job. Something similar is required in India. Since it is not happening from private sector, maybe it has to start from the government, and maybe steel development fund can be utilized, and maybe slowly, once it take off, even private sector may start investing.
Absolutely, sir. Thanks a lot. Yeah, so my next question, if Mr. Sharan Mahendra is there. Sir, are you there, Mr. Sharan?
Yes, I'm there.
Great. So what I wanted to actually understand from you, sir, while government, you know, in fact, in the past have also come up with a lot of fiscal incentives scheme to boost production and help the investors. But, you know, as they say, you know, devil lies in the detail. So an implementation has always been a matter of concern in terms of, you know, having, the regulatory burden, the ease towards availing incentives. So what would be your specific context so that we can, you know, expect the government to streamline the implementation mechanism for at least PLI?
Yes. See, PLI, we have to see that what its scheme says, that the weightage on the various parameters, the documents till now, which is available with us, I will say, are limited. Not very much the details we have. We have the broad contour of the scheme. But each and every factor, as I said, which I highlighted also when I spoke, Ganesh, that it's a 5-year scheme, we have to pay it and 6,500. But to the detail, the practicality and implementability of the scheme to get the real benefit is out of question and comes the way it is shown by us, shown to us. So it is very important. The definition, we have to go into the details to ensure possible bottlenecks in terms of implementing this scheme, and for which I will request the SOCHM to organize a discussion with the government body, with the stakeholders, wherein the points can be shared in advance so that a meaningful discussion can happen on all the points, the concerns we see in terms of implementing. Just to give an example, suppose someone has decided to, because you have to register for this scheme. What the scheme says that each manufacturer has to register for this scheme with certain terms. Suppose I register today, whether an investment which I'm just thinking, and I have initiated the process 2 months back or 3 months back, I can account for that or not, or after getting registered, whatever investment I propose. So there are lots of confusions, still doubts, which are. Those are, I think, not such that can become a bottleneck. But yes, it needs definite clarity. And the target is from 1st April 21. I think that the approximately only 22 months are left. It is very important to have this kind of discussion very fast. First, in the beginning, I joined before the session started with the was there. He said that though we were having the indication that many government officials will have also asked, will be present, thought that it will be more meaningful. I was told that the ministry has decided that no one is going to be present from the government side. But till the time all the stakeholders come with a comprehensive viewpoints and a paper. So I think it is important
Now the next step at the earliest is to organize a meeting with officials to keep this food, to avoid those doubts.
Sure, sir, we will do that. We have been asked to wait for 15 days. Okay. Then we will organize another round of meeting with the government officials so that detail on the basis of this discussion.
Right. And in fact, if on your side also, Kanish, I will say that from the industry, if you want any structured response, what all we have spoken. That also, I think, Goel Saab's view will be important. He can submit a written response, which can be combined by ASSOCHAM to submit a complete representation to the government.
No, I think absolutely, sir. It's obviously a very valid, you know, suggestion. Nahid, what we should do, in fact, you know, some of the Udyog Manthans I have moderated with DPIIT, and what they do is actually share a Google spreadsheet with all the, you know, panelists, and they give their suggestions on the Google spreadsheet, and that, you know, becomes a compendium which is you know, shared with the government officials and body. If Nahid, if that can be done, it would be, you know, great. It would be fantastic.
Thanks.
So, okay. Yeah, okay. Okay, sir. So with this, I'll come to my last question with Mr. Mahinder Gupta, who, you know, especially spoke about, you know, the application of specialty steel in defense and aerospace. Mr. Gupta, are you there?
Yeah.
So, sir, I mean, defense obviously is obviously one of the most strategic sectors for the country, and as obviously aerospace is. So, given this Indian, you know, offset opportunity, particularly this sector, and how do you see PLI or any other, you know, policy measure, you know, especially helping or assisting the sector towards capturing that opportunity better? Because what I understand from the industry, currently a lot of Indian offset partners are importing their requirements, their steel requirements. So how do you see that getting addressed from this PLI scheme?
Very good question, very pertinent. See, we have been, as a company, we had been trying our level best to get into this business. And we were told by even Bidhani, like, since you are part of this defense committee, we tried them directly, asking them approve and make the local manufacturers as their Indian office partners. Unfortunately, MNCs, the foreign MNCs, they don't budge at all, and they don't listen to us at all. Now it is only the Ministry of Defense, the Department of Production, the Secretary DP or his office can only influence them to and pressurize them to make new Indian offset partners. Then only it will generate good business. I can tell you, I mean, there is a sufficient data which says that there is an import of almost $1 billion which is happening in the country, which is mainly done by the offset partners. On the behest of foreign MNCs or Indian MNCs. So this will be a like kind of a low hanging fruit, which will immediately be termed as an export also, because all the offset obligations are termed as exports, and this will generate a good business for the Indian manufacturers as well. But then the Ministry of Defense has to play a very, very pivotal role and a decisive role in pushing them to appoint new Indian offset partners which can generate good business.
Absolutely, sir. So, with this, we come to the end of this session. And I once again would like to thank each and everyone who was present, during the session and shared their wonderful, valuable insights towards formulating PLI scheme, which is more investor oriented, which is more holistic in terms of developing the sector and augmenting the production capacities across segments, be it, you know, primary or be it secondary steel. So thanks a lot everyone for your time, and yeah,
thank you very much, Kanish.
Thank you, Kanish.
Thank you
so much, sir. Thank you
Nai.